I need you to take a course for intensive learning English. Because if you don't have a translator, it will be very, very difficult for you to understand. Yeah? In the Sangha might not come before mid of February. If he comes, yeah, he likes to stay in Pune. It's difficult for him to stay. But if you're here for 2 months, you know, I mean, then you should intensify your practice. Make the most out of it. Yeah? And that also includes, you know, dealing with pain and fear. Or even start. Puto. As I mentioned so often, you know, sati is so important. Right? And when we are interested about this and about that, you know, where is sati? Huh? We're constantly interested about what is going on here. When we take a trip, we're interested in what is going on outside. I mean, how can we develop sati? Sati is developed when we always come back to one point, to the same point. Not letting our senses going out into the world, yeah? Seeing what is going on there, seeing what is going on there. That's not the way to develop sati. And sati is important, you know. How will we realize, you know, if we are not on that point where things are happening. The point where things are happening is our heart. So we have to use samadhi in order to train the chitta to stay at the level of the heart. Once it can stay at the level of the heart, you know, it knows what is going on within the heart. It knows every reaction. It knows, you know, if their thought is going to be formed. It knows if there are some sensations coming in. And it knows that the chitta wants to go out in our 2D sensation. That's what the sati is all about. And then when we do investigation of the body, you know, then we use the sati, you know, to go to the point of the body, you know, to the organs or to the hair of the head or to the, to the skin or to the teeth or to the nails. Yeah? I mean, sati has to be there and it has to stay there, otherwise we don't see what is going on within the chitta. Huh? And if you don't know what is going on within the chitta, I mean, how do we do it differ from other people in this world? Yeah? I mean, they're all, you know, I mean, their attention is going here and going there and going there. And they think, you know, I mean, they live a life, yeah? But the life is lived for them. It's lived by the kilesas who are interested in what is going on within this world. That's the affairs of the kilesas. It's not the affair of Dhamma. Dhamma is interested in what is going on within the heart. Before things are coming. When a sensation is coming, sati knows there's a sensation. And then it stops there. It's not even interested if it is a sound or if it is a sight or if it is a feeling. Just stops there and goes back to the Buddha. Unless we investigate feeling. When we investigate, for instance, feeling of pain, then our sati goes to the point where the pain arises. Yeah? Seemingly arises. Then investigates that. What is pain? Or the same thing, when fear arises, what is fear? We are driven by fear. We are driven by by pain. Yeah? We just want some relief of the pain. And that's all what we can think about. relief from the pain. We want the pain to go away. We don't want to understand what is pain. We don't want to understand what is fear. We just want to get rid of fear. Just the same way, we want to get rid of our desires. That's why we follow the desires, because that's how we think, you know, that our desires to cease. When we give in to the desire, of course this desire ceases, but the next desire comes up. It's the same thing, you know, with hatred. Yeah? And when hatred comes out, we want to let it out because it is so burning. Yeah? So we put it onto an object, or we put it onto a person or an animal, yeah? And then we think it is gone. I mean, that's how the world operates, but that's not how we operate. As practitioners, you should understand. Yeah? I mean, what is it? You know, what is anger? You know, what is desire? If you constantly give in to desires, I mean, we know that from our own experience, nothing is solved. Yeah? One desire, you know, ceases to exist, the next desire comes up. Yeah? And then some desires that we can't, yeah? that we can't fulfill. Yeah? Or anger that we can't load off to onto somebody. And what are we going to do then? With dukkha, we suffer. Suffer from the desires we can't fulfill, suffer from the dukkha that we can't get rid of, from the hatred that we cannot get rid of. But that's not the way. Yeah? The way is not to give in to things. That's why we are called the recluse. Yeah? We're not only recluse from the world, but we're also recluse, you know, we guard the sense doors. And the sense doors, you know, I mean, whatever comes into the sense doors, or whatever comes into this room, we know it's coming into the room, but we don't let it disturb us. If people come into your room, you know, I mean, yes, hello, welcome, you know. Destroy me, yeah? Torment me, yeah? Make me feel bad. Yeah? Worries make us feel bad. It's useless, yeah? What to worry about? Yeah? Worry about the future, yeah? Worry about the past. The past we can't change, the future has not arisen. The only thing, you know, I mean, where we should put our attention is that present moment. This present moment, that's where we can change things. Yeah? But we let our attention slip to the things that come into the mind so that we can't stay in the present moment. Yeah? So we can't change anything. Constantly going out. Yeah? That's the way of the world. Yeah? The way of a recluse is, you know, to keep his senses protected. I mean, that's what the Lord Buddha said, didn't he? Protect your senses, the six senses, sight of seeing, sight of hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, and thinking. We don't protect them, you know, I mean, we just let them run around, creating havoc in our chitta. So, I mean, the first thing is, of course the first thing, you know, here in the monastery is to keep the five precepts, or for the monks, you know, to keep the 227 rules. Yeah. And you stay here as a lay person, you know, a practitioner, and you keep the eight precepts. Don't need to talk about that, you know, I mean, that is a prerequisite. The second thing is it has to train the mind to stay at one point. Once it can stay at a point, you know, for 15 minutes without deviation, then we can start to investigate. And we investigate the things that we believe is us. And that is the body, that is the main part. We always believe we are the body. Including the bodily field. The next thing is, after investigation of the body, investigation of the mental field. And then investigation of thoughts and memories. And then of consciousness. Until we understand all those things are not us. We constantly believe that these things are. It's my thought, it's my feeling. We cannot change these feelings when they come up. Just like we can't change the clouds when they come up. They just appear and then disappear. Rain, you know, appears and then disappears. The sun appears and then disappears. Can you make a change? No. Can you make your feelings that arise change and tell them I don't want you? No, you can't. Can you change your body? No, you can't. You just have to accept this body, as it is, whatever condition it is, accept it, and then live with it and make the most use of it. Use it, to practice, not to practice the body, but to practice the citta that inhabits it. That is the core of our practice. Developing sati, and then starting to investigate. When we develop sati, through samadhi, through the power of samadhi, then the only exception for the only exception, for not being on our Buddha or not being on our breath is when the pain becomes so strong that we cannot concentrate anymore on the Buddha or on the breath. And then we investigate pain. So we go to the point where we think or where we feel the pain is so strong. And then we ask, what is pain? Where is the pain? Is it anicca? Is it impermanent? Is it changing? And then we see, it's not constant. It cannot be constant. Nothing in this universe is constant. And then we ask, where is it? Is it in the leg? Is it in the knee? Is it point wise? Is it area wise? Then we ask, where exactly is the location? Is it in the skin? Is it an irritation of the skin? Is it in the muscles? Is it in the flesh? Is it in the bones? Where is it? And then really be interested, look where the pain is. And as I said often, before we can investigate the pain, we first have to accept the pain. Breathe in the pain like you breathe in the air, just accept the way it is. Otherwise you cannot investigate. Or you only investigate it, to get rid of it. And that is not investigation. That doesn't lead to the understanding of what is pain. So in most cases, in the beginning, once we put our interest on the pain, it just will disappear on its own accord. And then we go back to the Buddha or go back to the breath. Until it becomes stronger and stronger. And it stays. And then we can investigate. Then we can really dive into it. And then it doesn't disappear. It might move from one point to the other. And then we go to that, then we follow that path. We want to know where it's actually coming from. Even if you believe that we know that it's coming from the heart, that's not the way. It doesn't solve the problem. We have to see it. We have to see all the things. Understanding only takes place when we really see it happen. When we see it happen in how fear arises, when we see it happen in how worries arises, that's where understanding takes place. When we see where pain arises. So that's why we have to follow the pain until it shows us where it is actually originating. And that's a whole, and that's a whole purpose. Once we see it, once we understand it, that's the end of pain. Then there will be just physical pain, but no more mental pain. Because we understand where the pain is coming from. So the mental pain and the physical pain are separated. But it takes a long time. Don't think you can do it within 2 or 3 weeks. It might take years. Just like not giving in to our greed or not giving in to our hate. It might take years. So don't worry about it, you know. I mean, all what you worry is about, am I with my object of investigation or am I with my object of samadhi? That's the only thing you really have to worry about in your practice. In the morning you wake up until until in the evening where you go to sleep. And don't forget your daily reflection. Do it whenever you feel like it, yeah? But you know, go through the day. What happened? What did I think when I woke up? You know, what did I do then? Yeah? What came into my mind when I was standing up? What came into my mind when I was brushing? Yeah? What did I do then? What came into my mind? Yeah? What kind of sensation? What kind of feelings? What kind of thoughts? What kind of memories? Yeah? Recall as close as possible so that you understand, you know, the process that the kilesas take, yeah? To create the things that we believe are real. That's why we need this. That's why we need this recollection of the day. And we don't judge things if they are good or if they are bad. You know, we just observe it. You know, it's just like a recollection, you know, of the things that are happening. What happened exactly? And then we see how one thing, you know, leads to the other, and that, you know, that. Nurtures our understanding of the process of how the kilesas are working. And that's why the kilesas don't like it. They don't like us to do investigation because, I mean, they feel, you know, they feel like a magician, yeah? Who does these tricks, you know, and we go behind the stage and look at them. We cannot be pulled off by tricks that we understood, you know, how they are operating. Cannot be pulled off. But as long as we are pulled off by the tricks of the kilesas, that means we don't understand how they're created. And in order, you know, to understand it, that is the most valuable way, going through the day. If you can't do it in one go, you know, do it in two or three goes. One in the early afternoon, one in the early evening, and then one before you go to bed. You can do it, you know, do it in one go. I mean, it is valuable, it's not a waste of time. Don't think it's a waste of time. I mean, it sharpens our sati to stay with that moment. If you can't recall it, just go to the next one. Don't worry about it, don't ask too many questions, just ask it. What happened then? What did I think? Or what came into my mind? That's it. If nothing is coming, go to the next moment. If nothing is coming, go to the next moment. And you will see if you do that daily, I mean, this memory or this recollection will turn up a lot of things that you have not seen before. And that will lead to understanding. And understanding will lead to this illusion, or disenchantment. You understand it? So use the time when you are here well. Now it's time to ask. If you have any questions, you can ask. What is that?
It's a thought. It's like it's a thought.
Yeah, and what did I just talk about?
Not give it into.
Not give into a thought. Yeah. And before the thought, somebody else, something else came. What came before? Before that thought came. I mean, that is what I believe is the question. There was some sort of self-contact most of the time before a thought comes, right? Yes, and that are certainly enlightenment factors. Boredom is certainly an enlightenment factor. Laziness is certainly an enlightenment factor when I look at you. Yeah? Must be, you know, because it's, yeah, I mean, you cultivate it. Yeah? Speak up a little bit.
I have had a lot of opportunities recently to investigate pain and body discomfort.
Yeah.
And once more, I can see that when you see when you cannot do any more budo or press, try to ask the question, but it's so strong that I cannot even ask question. The only thing I can do is just observe that something is moving.
Yeah.
Not going from one place to another one, but inside it's moving.
Yeah, okay.
That's the only thing I can do.
Yeah, for the moment, then stay on it until there is still some resistance, that's why you can't ask questions.
Because and years after years, I feel it more difficult because it looks like with the body getting weaker and weaker, I don't find the strength to resist. So I can ask, because if not, I cannot ask.
Yeah, but I mean the thing that is missing here, before you can ask question, is the acceptance. Yeah? It's a nature. Just tell it. It's the nature of the body to get sick. It's the nature of the body to get weak. And there's nothing that I can do about it.
I have the feeling that I accept it completely.
Yeah, and then why can't you ask questions?
Because I'm too weak and I just
what is weak? then ask the question, what is weak? If you think you're weak, then ask the question, what is weak? Is the body weak? Is the mind weak? If the mind is weak, then it's still attached to this body, to the pain. So it is not objective, observing the pain.
Sure, I can see I cannot make the separation.
Okay, sure, yeah. Then, that is something that we have to work on, yeah? We need to make the separation, see that, there is pain, yeah? Then say, there is pain, until it separates out a little bit, yeah? The citta cannot be weak, or should not be weak. The citta is only weak when it associates with the pain, yeah? When it feels that it's my pain. Or it's my weak body. Any kind of thoughts that come in, yeah? Oh, my body is old. Yeah, I mean, you have to look at these thoughts. When these thoughts come in, then you have this connection. And when you have this connection, you cannot do investigation. So you have to separate it out. There is pain. Pain is not me. Who observes the pain? Then just ask the question, who observes the pain? Who knows that there is pain? Yeah? And who makes this stupid comment that it's because of a weak old body? Who makes this comment? And you believe it. And that's how they trick you. That's what I just said before. We have to understand the tricks, how they trick us. Yeah? Yeah, this pain is me, it's my old body. Yeah? Oh, I work too much, I'm so tired. The body is tired, but the chitta is not tired. That's how they trick us. By associating, that the pain is us. That's why we have to use the principle of anatta. That's not me, that's not mine, it doesn't belong to me. I can observe it, If I can observe it, who is the one who observes it? The one who observes it is always strong. He's always weak. It is only weakened in the moment, it associates with this, yeah? It takes hold of it, as me and mine and myself. You understand?
And I try to do that work since I'm 20 years old. No way.
Don't worry, the trip to to Beijing starts with the first step. If you do one step in the right direction, at least you're a step ahead, yeah? But if you say, I'm so tired, yeah? Let's go back because behind me there's a nice restaurant, yeah? Then we go back, yeah? Or go back to our sense desire. Training, Michelle, it's just pure training. Don't expect anything, you know, just train yourself. Yeah. Until you get so, you get so interested in the training itself that you don't even worry about the result. Things don't happen around on the spot. I'm so trained. Athletes know that, they don't get a gold medal, on the first day of their training. It's tough training, yeah? Isn't it? Okay, any other question? William?
No.
Andy? No. She first has to understand what was taught. So you can explain it a little bit, after. Whatever you understood. This is the Sotapanna, der die Frucht erreicht hat, und der eine hat den Eintritt als Sotapanna gemacht und der andere hat die Frucht des Sotapannas erreicht. Sotapanna Mak, Sotapanna Pon. Mak is the path normally, and normally for Sotapanna, it happens instantly, they both come at the same time. But it can happen, that's why, when we chant, when we chant about the Sangha, there are eight kinds of people. There's a person, who reaches the Magga of Sotapanna, so the path moment, and the one who has the fruit of Sotapanna. Yeah? And that's the same for Sakadagami. In most cases, for Sotapanna and Sakadagami, the fruit comes mostly at the same time. The fruit and the mug, yeah? The path moment and the fruit come at the same time, or very shortly after. That doesn't necessarily mean for an anagami or an arahant. They can be very, very different. Yeah? Can take a long, much longer time. Can take days or weeks. Yeah?
Actually, there's a question also I heard, because as Buddha speaks about some kind of person,
I don't understand.
As Buddha speaks about that eight kind of person, it means that if systematically Magga, Phala, or Sotapanna follow Magga, he will speak only about seven kind of people.
No, it's the same thing for Arahant. Arahant has a Magga and has a Phala.
Usually, we say for Sotapanna, fruition follow Magga instantly, some mind moment after.
Yeah.
But if it follows some mind moment after, there is no time to be one kind of person.
Yes, of course, in these few moments. in most cases. The Lord Buddha knew all the cases, yeah? That's why he said there's Sotapanna Mak, there's Sotapanna Pon, yeah?
And that is something I found in Rinpo Wangchai's book that he wrote. He wrote about the entrance in the Sotapanna Magga.
Yeah.
And as really an event.
Yeah. Yes, it is an event.
And also,
it is really an event, but the fruit, comes, it follows, for most people, it follows very quickly, not a few mind moments later. Yeah? The evening or the next day, or whatever. Yeah? It follows so quickly that, that you don't sometimes don't even realize it. Yeah? But for some people, it is very distinct. That's why the Lord Buddha said, there is Mak and there is Pon. Yeah? Pon sind die Früchte. Not going to hell, and so on, yeah?
That's good to
not going back, entering the stream, knowing that one never can go back into the worldly life. That is, for instance, the fruit of Sotapanna.
It's good to good to have it clear, because usually it's always said that it's for immediately.
No. I mean, immediately, you know, I mean, it is, you know, it can be hours, it can be days, yeah? But for the person, you know, who experiences it, you know, it might be immediately, yeah? Because he doesn't realize. But it always takes a few days, you know? Or a few hours, you know, to get the fusion, yeah? Because the muck is so deep, you know, that first of all, you're so surprised, yeah? Just like for Lunga Mahapur, I was so surprised, you know. I mean, how can the Buddha and the Dhamma and the Sangha be one and the same thing? He didn't have the fruition yet, yeah? The fruition came later. The fruition that he is free, you know, that he knows, you know, the fruition that he knows, you know, these things, you know, I mean, he's free, he's done his work. When he experienced the Makkha, he experienced only, you know, it's an amazing experience, yeah? That something has been cut loose, yeah? But he might not know what has been cut loose at that time. Only later on he realized, oh, that's gone, all the krisas are gone. But he not, in the moment where the Makkha, yeah, where the path moment, he does not realize what happened. He just sees these things, yeah? And he lets go of it, but he does not know yet the truth. So that will be always separate, yeah? But for a person, you know, it might come instantly or immediately, yeah? Because that mind fulfilling, you know, that experience is so overpowering that he doesn't see, you know, the truth coming, yeah? He only realizes it, you know, that the truth is coming later. Yeah? Suddenly you realize, oh, I'm not going to hell. Oh, we don't know. I don't know. Just came up, the knowledge. And that is the fruit that comes up. Okay? Understood? It's always distinct, yeah? It's not, it doesn't take only seconds, yeah? That's why the Lord Buddha said, you know, it's for our hand, it's the same thing. But for them, you know, why I said, you know, immediately, or for most of the people, sort of, because the Makkha moment is not that amazing, that it comes very quickly, within the next few days, yeah? But for an Anagami or Arahant, it can be weeks, yeah? Or even months. Okay? Now, Benny? So, more questions? Tom? So, Tom Richard, you take this, you know, and practice hard, yeah? When you go into Dhamma, yeah? And don't worry about anything, yeah? Just come back in the right time for the visa. That's always the trouble with our visa time, you know, that it is really in the middle of Dhamma. Yeah? Next time you just go after the panta. And then you have more time. Okay, so then we stop. Yeah. You see the battery is over below. Yeah, I mean that is going, you know, I mean, Thudong means being on wandering, being a wandering monk, yeah? I mean, a wandering monk stays, you know, can stay in a monastery for one day or 2 days, yeah? I can stay, and now I can stay there for 3 days if he likes it, yeah. And it took all means, you know, you stay at a place if you like, and you stay there until you know you feel you need to go, and then you go to another place. That means, you know, Tudong. I mean, Lumpuman was staying, you know, in Tudong, he was staying in Salika cave for 3 years, yeah, so, but he still was in Tudong. Yeah?
Chinese fan.